Hello everyone, Olga-Show. Today is June 10th, 2013. We are with Leroy Chiao, who is actually speaker at SWOT, which is Silicon Valley Open Doors event here in, at Computer History Museum, which located in Mountain View, California, part of Silicon Valley as well. Hello Leroy, nice to see you. You're one of the first person we talk in Ambark, another Russian speaking event.
Right.
And they said we have Astronaut coming and he would be at SWOT. And everybody like, yes, that's great. I wanted to be an astronaut.
Oh, great, okay.
So, but life turned around. I became a scientist, mm-hmm. which you are a scientist as well.
Right.
And you are an astronaut. So tell me, did you dream about becoming an astronaut?
Yes, I did. I was 8 years old when Apollo 11 landed on the moon. And I had always been interested in airplanes and rockets and building things. And so, but it was that moment that made me realize and think about wanting to become an astronaut myself. And so it was something that was always in the back of my mind. And I studied engineering, it was natural, but I went and studied chemical engineering because I was always interested in technical things. And so that enabled me to apply to the program. And I was fortunate enough to be interviewed and selected to be a NASA astronaut.
So when you have been selected, how old have you been?
I was 29. And,
29, so wow, I could have still have a chance to become. I'm only 20 for yeah. many years now, but yeah, I thought you will be selected. Will be selected about 18 or 17, but 29 is.
Actually, the average age of a successful astronaut candidate is probably closer to 33, 34. So NASA selects from people who have already been out working in a different career. That you know, they want to see people who have done something, who demonstrated some ability, and then you know are interested in coming to NASA to apply some of those abilities.
Wow, interesting. So you were graduated as chemical engineer.
Yes.
From which university?
I went to school as an undergraduate at the University of California at Berkeley, and then went down to UC Santa Barbara for my master's and PhD in chemical engineering.
Wow, that's a very big scientific background you have. Did you have to learn how to fly the ship?
Well, I actually learned how to fly. I learned how to fly airplanes because I was interested when I was a graduate student. And I never actually learned how to fly the shuttle per se. I flew the simulator because one of my jobs was testing flight software. So I knew the principles and I've actually practiced in the simulator flying the shuttle. But the actual flying of the space shuttle was left to the military test pilot astronauts who were selected for that task.
Perfect. So now you are a chemical engineer. Did you make any experiments, which I would like to know?
Sure.
Because you're here in the space.
Yeah, we did a lot of experiments in space. Of course, that's one of the primary reasons we go into low Earth orbit. And so we performed a lot of different experiments. Roughly speaking, I would say half of the experiments we perform are on kind of the biomedical side because we want to understand the effects of the environment on human bodies and what we do to help mitigate the bad things. And the other half is probably roughly material science, looking at new materials, new alloys that we can form in microgravity, and then, you know, a few other little experiments as well, of course.
Now, I know you have the flag, which is Russian-American flag as well,
yep.
So did you fly Russians
yes.
space?
Yes, my fourth mission, I flew with, I trained for many years, and I flew with the Russian cosmonaut, and we were a crew on the International Space Station. So I launched on the Baikonur Cosmodrome on the Soyuz, and I was the co-pilot of the Soyuz. And once we went to the space station, I was the commander and NASA science officer of the space station during 6.5 months. And so this was part of our mission patch. We were the 10th expedition, so we took the two flags and made a Roman numeral 10.
Very good. So how many total space trips did you make?
I flew four times. Three times aboard space shuttles and then four times to the space station aboard Soyuz.
So the longest stay was 6.5 months?
Right. Mm-hmm.
So tell me, like, from shorters, how many days did you stay?
On the short missions were 10 to 14 days. And so accumulated over three missions was somewhat over 30 days in space, maybe 30 somewhere around 30 days. And then the long duration flight was 193 days. So all told, I was in space almost 230 days.
Was it adaptation period? Was it longer adaptation period after longer trip?
After coming back?
Yes.
Yes, it definitely was. After a space shuttle mission, maybe a couple of days. And then back to the space station. We actually recovered very quickly. We exercised very hard, and so we actually recovered in about a week. Most crews take 2 or 3 or even 4 weeks.
Is it because of the muscle?
It's a lot of the balance. You know, you're very dizzy, and so you really have to force yourself to walk and work on your balance.
Not fly, like you wanted to fly, you don't feel that?
No, you just feel very dizzy.
When you are in the space, would you feel dizzy or you feel like
when you first approach, when you first get into space, you're also dizzy, and it takes you a day or two to get over that.
Do you have nausea kind of feeling?
You can, yes. And both going up and coming down, it depends on the individual. For me, going up is not a problem. For me, coming down, I feel a little nauseous and a little sick.
Now, in terms of the eating food, mm-hmm. how do you feel? Do you need to use the tubing food?
No, we use we can use spoons. You know, we use a lot of food items that are in a can or in a packet. And so we can, you know, just use spoons to.
But would it fly away from the spoon?
Well, you have to be careful. And of course, you don't bring food that's very crumbly. Things are more sticking together.
Okay, that's interesting because I definitely now imagining what you could do in space, and it's very exciting. Well, I know that they're talking about Mars trips and stuff. Would you go to other planets?
Well, my dream was to go to the moon when I was young, and unfortunately, we have not been, nobody's been back to the moon since 1972.
That's so bad.
And there's no current plan to go to the moon. So I knew that it was time, you know, I would probably not have the opportunity to fly to the moon myself. And so, you know, after 15 years and 4 missions, I decided it was time to leave NASA and go to other things.
Wow. So do they have a limit in the age where you can...
No, not really. Not formally. You just have to stay healthy. And, you know, so, you know, the oldest professional astronaut to fly was probably in his, I think he was 61. So, still flew at that age.
All right, so where did you shift your gears from?
Well, I got interested in business, and so I worked in a commercial space company, a startup, and unfortunately that didn't work out, but I learned a lot from that experience, and so now I continue to work with some entrepreneurial ventures. I work for Mike Sander, a guy named Mike Sander, who was the founder and CEO of Epifan, who's one of the sponsors of Spod. And in fact, using the company, basically the company's products are used to capture high resolution video and to record it and stream it. And in fact, this conference is being streamed live using our equipment and also recorded.
That's very good. Maybe we should use it for our live streaming of my show, my radio.
We can help you.
Business, like I always do deals right at the interview sometimes because life is precious and.
Sure.
As I meet a lot of interesting people, that's always help. Have you had a chance to also have a practice at Baikonur for how many months?
Yes, well, of course, I went down for training. I was a backup crew first, so I spent time at Baikonur with a crew that did fly, and I was their backup. And then I went back again for my launch, of course. And then after that, I went back as an escort for another astronaut and his family to take care of them.
Wow, did you learn Russian language?
Oh yes, I had to learn the Russian language. I studied during my 3.5 months of training for my mission. And, you know, of course, being a member of the crew of Soyuz, I had to speak Russian with the crew and the flight controllers. And then from the station, and we talked to the mission control center in Russia, I had to speak in Russian.
So, what about the Russian crew? Did they learn English?
They had to learn English, yes.
So
same
when sometimes like you can communicate in both languages,
yes,
or how I communicate at home, half Russian, half English, or one third Russian English and some other Russian dialects.
It just depends. If you're talking to the American Mission Control Center, of course we speak English. If you're talking to Moscow, we speak Russian. And then amongst each other, we spoke a lot of Russian. I think mostly Salajan's English was fine, but he was more comfortable speaking Russian, and I didn't mind the practice. So.
Okay, I know we will do separate programming where we will speak Russian only, so you have to check our other part where we will do specifically in Russian, and then we will see how that will go.
We'll see how much I remember.
Yes, and so when you will come today for the dinner presentation, or before the dinner a little bit, then you would be totally prepared and practice.
There you go.
So it will be like for you before the show. Now, for our viewers, what would you wish them?
Well, I mean, is your viewer, you mean in terms
viewers,
of
viewers, we have, in Russia, we will have SWAT. Yeah. We participated in our conference, Silicon Valley Open Doors, that's why it's called SWAT. Mm-hmm. Also, we have people in California and all over the world.
Sure.
So
well, I think in general, the most important thing is for everybody to figure out what they want to do with their lives, so whether it's something in entrepreneurship or in a company or in academia or any other endeavor in the arts. And so I think the important thing is to figure out what you want to do and go after them. I think I'm probably on my third or fourth career now, so so it can change, but it's important to keep moving forward.
Does it help you to actually free from far above? Sometimes they say you just look up. And you saw a whole planet Earth, how small it is in level.
Yeah.
So would it make you feel more stronger? Do they give you adventure approach in your life?
Well, I think it gives you perspective. It certainly gave me perspective to view the Earth from space. So it helped me to kind of think about what was important, and that's one of the lessons I took away, was that how important it is to do something that you love.
And the other thing, I always thinking, you're here in the space, or far away in the space, and all these meteors running and flying, how is that? I mean, you see them very close by here,
well,
you don't think about them.
You can't see them in space, of course, because it's generally pretty far away, but even the ones that come close, you can't see them because of the lighting conditions necessarily. What you can see is you can look down at the Earth and you can see the meteorites entering the Earth, so you're watching shooting stars from above. It's kind of interesting.
Is it blue from far away?
No, it's also white light, mostly white light.
Okay. All right, interesting. Well, here, Leroy Chiao, astronaut, scientist, entrepreneur right now, and speaker at SWAT here at Computer History Museum. This was Olga-Show with you. Watch our second part, which will be in Russian.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.